Thank you, Jan. Tonight we have with us three terrific musicians that make up Black Oak Ensemble. They are violinist Desiree Rustrat, violist Aurelien Petterzoli, and cellist David Cunliffe. Their program tonight is essentially a sampler of two projects with which they've been involved, and both of them have resulted in acclaimed releases on the CD label. They are Silenced Voices and Avant l'Orage, and we'll learn a lot more about them later on in the program. But to begin the evening, we have some very familiar music by J.S. Bach in an arrangement by the violinist and composer Dmitri Sutkovetsky. He has arranged the Goldberg variations for string trio, thus enabling yet another ensemble of instrumentalists to revel in the playing of this great music. So here is the aria from the Goldbergs, played for us by Black Oak Ensemble.
Thank you.
Dmitri Sitkovetsky's arrangement of the aria, which begins the Goldberg Variations of Johann Sebastian Bach. We're listening to Black Oak Ensemble. It is a live broadcast from WFMT. And we're about to hear music from one of their quite wonderful projects. We'll get to that in a moment, but I think maybe the first thing to talk about is the fact that you are a string trio, which is a wonderful thing and sort of a rare thing, as is repertoire for a string trio. There is some very good stuff out there, but I think part of what you folks do so well is find more.
Right. So, yes, I mean, obviously that first piece was an arrangement, actually an incredibly good arrangement. And in fact, we've just found out how difficult it is to arrange music. And so we've had to do a little bit of that just because of the type of music that we want to play. But yeah, it was a real discovery. I mean, we didn't think there was that much music written for string trio, but we kept on discovering more and more music, and it's been a real journey.
Well, let's focus in on the first project we're going to hear about tonight, and that is the Silenced Voices project, which resulted in a quite wonderful CD, released, I guess, a couple of years ago now. Tell us, Aurelien, how this all began and what it's about.
Well, the story goes that David and Desiree were on a Ravinia cruise, which may sound like they were working, but I don't think they were. They came back with a pile of music for string trio. And most of it we had never heard of. And so we sat down and our process, if you want to be creative and call it a process, is that we sit down and we just read a bunch of music until we find something that appeals to us. And most of this music was incredibly good and incredibly unknown to us. And so we started digging a little bit and researching when those pieces were composed. And at the time, my mother, who was a history teacher in high school, was reading a book called Music at Terezin, which basically talked about the music that was composed during the Terezin years, which Terezin is a ghetto outside of Prague called Terezinstadt, which at first is where the intelligentsia from Prague was put by the Nazis, and then slowly it became a Jewish ghetto and finally a final solution place. And out of four of those pieces that they brought back, three of them were written in Terezin during German occupation. And so we thought there is something there because the music touched us first. As music, we had no context to it. And we just fell in love with the music itself and with the composer. And then finding out the circumstances in which these pieces were written just kind of gave us an impetus to find more about it, and that's how the project Silent Voices was born. And we got in touch with a wonderful foundation in LA called the Orel Foundation, which is run by James Conlon and Bob Elias. And actually, Bob Elias ended up writing the program notes for the album, and a great foundation in the Netherlands called Forbidden Music Regained. And that foundation put us in touch with a couple Dutch families, one of which is one of the pieces we play tonight. And we had to, when you play Beethoven and Mozart, it's really fun. It's great music, but you don't get to talk to Beethoven's great cousin and ask right. him about. But you can do that with this kind of music, and it's a privilege to have been able to meet those people and learn more about those composers who died extremely young.
Let's talk about this first composer that we're going to hear, Dick Kattenburg, who was, in fact, born in Amsterdam. He was a Jewish violinist, a composer. He was born in 1919. He died at Auschwitz in 1944, student of Leo Schmidt. And much of his work, I guess, was found in an attic by a family member fairly recently, I think in 2004. But what can you tell us about this piece? I guess it's got a lot of youthful vigor in it.
Well, I mean, we're very lucky that he had a romance with a young flautist called Ema, and it was thanks to her that all his manuscripts were preserved, including this string trio. Yeah, we loved this piece as immediately we played it. It's got a very jazzy feel. I think that was one of his main influences. Also Kattenberg had a passion for drawing as well. And when we first got this music, he had doodled all these sort of images of Nazi soldiers giving Nazi salutes on the front of this, on the cover of this string trio. And it's just fascinating, and it really brought it home in a very real way, what this was all about.
Let's hear the piece. This is the trio accord by Dick Kattenberg, as performed by violinist Desiree Rustrat, violist Aurelien Petterzoli, and cellist David Cunliffe. Thank you. music by young Dick Kattenburg, his Trio Accord, as performed by Black Oak Ensemble, our guests tonight on Live from WFMT. We're concentrating now on silenced voices, silenced during the Holocaust, and rediscovered by Black Oak Ensemble and recorded by them. We turn next to Gideon Klein, who was a Czech pianist and composer, who led much of the cultural life in the Terezín concentration camp, and he died during the liquidation of the Fürstengrube camp in 1945. This is his trio for violin, viola, and cello, three-movement work, and it, I think, relies to a certain extent on the native folk material of his country.
Moravian,
okay.
Was a country at the time of his, when he was alive. And the second movement is a variation on theme, Moravian themes. Gideon Klein is one of those pieces. That trio is one of the pieces that started this project. And it was written in Terezín, and we were extremely honored and lucky to be able to perform this music in Terezinstadt, where it was written and premiered.
Oh, really?
During a festival called Festival of Everlasting Hope. And it was very powerful. We got to play this piece, and on the album there are also pieces by another Czech composer named Hans Kasa, who was a lot more famous at the time. He had music performed by George Schell and the Philadelphia Orchestra. And Gideon Klein was an up-and-coming composer, already well-known, but not to the level of Kasa. What's interesting about the Czech part of the album is that I think on YouTube you can find a video of the Red Cross coming through Theresienstadt, and the Nazis used it as propaganda. There were fake windows with fake shops, and one of the pieces by Hans Krasa was being performed, which is Brundibar, which is a Yiddish opera for children. And when this project all came together, we realized that the neighbors of David and Desiree, the monks, the mother and father met in Theresienstadt. And the mother was, in fact, this little girl singing in the video. Mm. And so it's, in all kinds of ways, this project really hit very closely home for us. And we have, I mean, we'd be remiss if we didn't thank Jim Ginsberg and SETI Records for affording us ability to record this music, because yep. It was a bit of a gamble.
Right.
You know, it's not the funnest project ever, but it's fantastic music. But yeah, so like the second movement is very much based on, you know, Moravian theme. The last movement is a bit of a peasant dance, if you will, with a lot of accents. And the first movement, we didn't realize that until after we played it in Terezín, where someone mentioned that it sounded like there is a train driving through the first movement, which would make sense, because that's unfortunately all they would hear most of the day.
Yeah.
And I think one of the most incredible things, especially about this piece, is the second movement is quite quite emotional. I think it's both to listen to and to play every time we play it. And then he ends with this movement that is so uplifting and very fun, and to think in the circumstances he was able to write music like that is just so extraordinary. We think this is just an incredible piece.
Right. Let us hear it. This is Gideon Klein's trio for violin, viola, and cello, played by Black Oak Ensemble. Thank you. Music by Gideon Klein, his trio for violin, viola, and cello. Our violinist tonight is Desiree Rustrat, our violist, Aurelien Petterzoli, and our cellist, David Cunliffe, and together they are Black Oak Ensemble. We are focusing in on one of their projects, Silenced Voices, and we have one more selection from that album on City Records. It is by Chandra Kuti, who lived from 1908 to 1945. He was born in Budapest in 1908, and he was a Hungarian Jewish composer. Thought that he died in 1945, as I mentioned, but under circumstances that aren't entirely clear. One thing that is clear is that he was perhaps one of the great hopes for music in Hungary at the time. Sir George Schulte, who knew him while they were both students at the Franz Liszt Academy, once said that had this gentleman lived, he would have become one of Hungary's greatest composers. Let us talk a bit about Kuti and your discovery of him and this particular piece.
Well, Kuti was one of these composers that we found this music in a bookstore, a music store in Budapest a number of years ago, and we just were totally unfamiliar with the name. And we brought this back, we did a bit of research, we discovered that this was actually one of three string trios that he'd written. The other two are a little difficult to get hold of at the moment. We're hoping to perhaps one day perform the other two. But this is a really beautiful piece in three movements. And yeah, Kerry, I mean, you mentioned that Sir George Scholte said he would have become one of Hungary's greatest composers if he had lived. And I would just add to that, I mean, we don't really know much about his life, obviously, because, you know, he died so young. He did come from an extremely poor family, we do know that. And we also know that he wrote a beautiful violin sonata that survived because basically it was smuggled out of Auschwitz. But this music was written on paper that he himself had made in Auschwitz, which is pretty unbelievable. And it's sort of remarkable that it even survives. And that's a very, very beautiful piece. But we're going to play the third movement, which is it's quite short. And it features the cello, which is probably why I'm talking about it so much. It's a very beautiful melody. But it finishes on this very unusual chord. And we like to think of it as a chord of hope. It's a chord of optimism. And it's really a very unique piece.
Thank you.
That was the third movement, Adagio Monotropo, from Sandor Kuti's Serenade for String Trio. We're listening to Silenced Voices, a project of Black Oak Ensemble. Black Oak Ensemble consists of violinist Desiree Rustrat, violist Aurelien Petterzoli, and cellist David Cunliffe. And the commercially released recording of that piece and the others we've listened to tonight is available on a compact disc from City Records. It's widely available. We're going to turn to another project of Black Oak Ensemble in a moment, but first we're going to take a break. Jen? Thank you, Jan. We're back in the studio with Black Oak Ensemble, and we're about to talk about another project of theirs, Avant l'Orage. And this is, I suspect, having to do with the period before World War II, before the storm, as yes. It were in translation. And some of the music we're going to hear is by Henri Tomasi, Gabriel Pierney, and Jean Croise. But let's begin at the beginning, really. Most of these pieces, I think, resulted from the activities of a particular trio, the Pasquier Trio. They championed a lot of this music, did they not?
Yeah. Well, the Pasquier Trio was the only game in town.
Uh-huh.
Just as, like, string trios are not the most biggest ensembles in the world, Pasquier Trio, in fact, was. It was made of three brothers, all named Pasquier, you guessed it. They were principal of different orchestras in Paris, and they basically championed the music of their time, which happened to be an extremely interesting time between Impressionistic and the 12 tones, basically. And, you know, if you look at brochures from Carnegie Hall and Salle Pleyel, it's Budapest Quartet and Pasquier Trio, and that's it. Every other ensemble is less well known. And like you said, out of seven composers, this album, again on CD, is Avant l'Orage, is seven composers, a double album. And I would say 85% of the music on this album has been written for the Pasquier brothers. Their sons are actually fantastic musicians as well, Régis Pasquier and Bruno Pasquier, both violists and violinists. Right. But it's interesting because one of the pieces, Pierre-Ney, is actually written on their names. Pierre-Ney wrote a fugue with the name of each of the Pasquier brothers, Jean, Étienne, and Pierre. It's really, really interesting. But this project, Avant l'Orage, which incidentally I think is humorous, at least to me, that the first project we did, Silent Voices, was partly driven by my mother, who was a historian, and the second project, my father came up with the title. So I think I got to start paying them something.
I think so.
But Avant l'Orage is that period between the First and the Second World War where things at first are wonderful and hopeful, the crazy years in Paris, and then slowly it becomes darker. Some of the music that is closest to 1939 is really, you can hear it in the music, and maybe that's, you know, putting context on the audience, but it's we could hear it. But it started because for a very long time the trio was playing a piece by Jean Krah, which is a piece we'll finish the program with. And we loved it, and we wanted to record it. And then we were in Corsica for concerts. Corsica is wonderful. If you haven't been, you should. And Desiree, who likes to ask every time we go anywhere if anyone has written a string trio, asked, has anyone in Corsica written a string trio? And the presenter said, well, you might want to try Tomasi. And Tomasi is very famous. If, God forbid, you played the trombone or the trumpets,
right,
you would know the concertos, because to get into the Chicago Symphony, you probably have to play those pieces. It's very jazzy, very great recording by Winston Marsalis. We found this sitting in a library in Paris. It sounds very Harry Potter-like, but in a library in Paris, there was a ton of string trios written by French composers during that time period. First edition that had never been sold. So basically they had been composed, premiered, printed, and forgotten. And I should make a t-shirt. and we got a lot of them, enough for two double albums. And we really had to wade through it and look for it.
So Tomasi lived from 1901 to 1971. And I guess he wanted to become a sailor, but his father wouldn't allow that, so he studied music.
Actually, an interesting thing is there is a wonderful video of Tomasi and the violinist Zino Francescatti were great friends.
Yes, right.
And when they got into the conservatoire, Francescatti wanted to become a composer, and Tomasi was going to become a pianist. Uh-huh. Well, it didn't turn out that way. But they have this wonderful conversation about how Ravel kind of plays a piano, which I thought was pretty funny. And we met Tomasi's son, Claude, who endeavors to popularize his father's music, and in 2021 was his the birthday or centenary of his death. And we got to play the music for him, and he had never heard it before.
One of the great things about COVID that came out of COVID was actually...
There was something great?
There was something great. Yeah. It was this CD, just because we had the time to do all this research, and actually we spent probably a couple hours on Zoom.
Yeah.
Oh, you know, him in Corsica, us here playing the piece, asking him how his father would have wanted it, and
well, and one of the tunes. So David loves to remind me that Tomasi was in fact born in Marseille and not Corsica. I don't think David would say that in Corsica, because I don't think David would come back from Corsica. But he in fact was born in Marseille. But throughout the whole piece, there is this Corsican shepherd song that runs through. Mm-hmm. It's very, when you listen to the piece, you hear it. And talking to his son, he, you know, identified that for us, which was very cool. And then when we played it in Corsica, maybe a year and a half ago, this old man came to see us after the concert and said, you know, there is another popular tune in there. It's about cutting aristocrats and nobles' head off.
Oh, how nice.
Which, you know, may or may not be relevant today.
This is, we're going to hear three movements of it, not the entire piece. The first, second, and fourth movement. The first movement is marked Prelude, the second, Nocturne, and the fourth movement, Finale. Here is the Trio à cordes en forme de divertissement by Henri Tomasi.
Thank you. Thank you.
music by Henri Tomasi. We heard three movements from the string trio in the form of a divertissement, Prelude, Nocturne, and Finale, as performed by Black Oak Ensemble. It's part of the project Avant l'Orage. This is French music from between the wars, between World War I and World War II. And we're going to continue very shortly with music by Gabriel Pierney. But first, I do want to remind you that video of tonight's concert can be found at WFMT.com or WFMT's Facebook and YouTube channels. Now, Pierney may be the best known composer, probably, with the exception of Bach, on the program. Let's talk about how he fits into the picture here.
Well, he's a French composer who wrote music in between the two wars. So that was enough for us. But he also wrote a string trio, which is a fantastic piece, very caustic, very, very ironic, and very, very dedicated to the Pasquier trio. But like you said, in the album, he's one of the best known names. There's him, there's Francais, which is a string trio no one can get ahead of. And then, the Kazatsu and the other composers on the album are known for other reasons. But Pierney is known as a composer. He was also known as a president of the conservatory or the director of the French conservatoire back in those times. And he wrote this piece in four movements that is extremely romantic and very interesting. And actually, the first time we read it, we discarded it and we thought, not for us. And David and I, or mostly David, came up, found a recording of the Pasquier brothers playing the first movement in a very, very romantic early 20s ways with slides everywhere. And we were like, oh, that makes sense now. And we went back to it and realized that, you know, it needed that kind of spice in order to, like, for us to understand it, which is, I find, really cool. But it's become a piece that we absolutely love playing. And the second movement, a lot of those trios, actually, the second movement has a lot of, like, viola melodies, which...
You don't mind?
I don't mind. Maybe people do, but I don't. And a lot of them, the chanson in the Kazatsu, we have the Legend, and then the one you heard earlier, the Nocturne, with a croix. But it's a very quirky piece. The first movement, like I said earlier, the first movement is dedicated to the Pasquier brothers, and he invents a special scales for every one of their names, writes a fugue upon it, which is, I find, really cool, very difficult to play also.
So we're going to hear the second movement only from the piece, the chanson. This is Gabriel Pierney's chanson from the Trois Pièces en Trio. Thank you. the chanson, the second movement of the trois pièces en trio by Gabriel Pianet, performed by the members of Black Oak Ensemble, our guests tonight on Live from WFMT. Two more selections from their project, and this featuring French music from between the world wars. And the music we're going to hear now is by one Gustave Samazeux. He lived from 1937 to 1967. He was known as a great music critic, among other things. And also, he at one point declared that he was an acolyte of Debussy, unquestionably. David, what can you tell us about him?
Well, first, Kerry, I think your pronunciation is excellent. I don't know how to say this guy's name. Samazeux, there are a lot of redundant letters in his name as far as I'm concerned. S-A-M-A-Z-E-U-I-L-H.
Isn't there two M's?
Not in my part here. Okay. Anyway, so we had a lot of fun over this about actually how to pronounce his name. So I'm going to turn it over to Aurelien, actually, just to, for the final verification on this.
It's Samazeux.
Oh, Samazeux.
Was that close?
Huh?
That was close.
Yeah, yeah. You were very good.
All right,
yeah.
Okay.
I've always been very good with French pronunciation. No, it's a very fun piece. It's actually, it's kind of a, those books, Find Your Own Adventure, because it's written in a very Baroque style. It does not sound Baroque, and we're not quite sure if it was supposed to be a humoristic take on Baroque music or if it was supposed to be very stern and academic. And being the very stern and academic people that we are, we decided to go with a more humoristic take of it. And the movement that we're playing tonight, the first movement, is a very noir, you know, like film noir, you know, the damsel in distress, the light just on the eye as he's driving the car, you know, this, you can imagine that a little bit.
It's very, very French sounding.
And then the other movement is Desiree's, probably Desiree's favorite movement in all of music literature. She makes us play it every single time. And it's a divertissement. And I don't know why she likes it so much. Why do you like it so much,
I like
Desiree?
It so much because we all have to really pay attention because it's a very humorous... You'll hear. It's an incredibly humorous movement that you can that you can do many things with, and I think I've done many things with it, and they never know what we're about to do, so that's what's fun about it.
One of those. All right, two movements from this music of Gustave Samazeux. That was close, I suppose. And we'll hear the Prelude and Divertissement, performed by Black Oak Ensemble. Well, that was fun. That was the Divertissement movement. And before that, the prelude from the suite for violin, viola, and cello by Gustave Samazoul. It was played for us by the Black Oak Ensemble. There is one more selection we'll hear from their project Avant l'Orage. But first, I want to find out from you folks what you've been up to, both during the pandemic and after, and how it's been going.
Well, like I said earlier, one of the great things that came out of the pandemic was this project and being able to have the time and where we could all spend researching, making discoveries, and actually that people had the time to talk with us and a lot of the family members. That was really an incredible experience for us to have, you know, especially with the time gap. It all worked out really beautifully over Zoom, and it seemed like each composer led to another composer, which made, you know, this project wonderful. And now that we are coming out of COVID, we were very lucky this past summer. Newport Festival, which is a really large chamber music festival, you know, I think thought they were taking a little bit of a gamble by programming an entire program of silenced voices, meaning that was our whole recital. And it went over really well, and it was really wonderful to be able to bring the music and to bring the story to everyone. And so the summer we had spent getting back into concerts, and we went back to France and were able to play actually this repertoire on its home territory. And we even also got a Schubert quintet at Schubert Tiad,
wow,
which was really a fun thing with the wonderful Swiss violinist Rachel Colley, and Nadege was the cellist, and it was a wonderful collaboration. And we have a number of things coming up, including another chance on programming in Miami. They're actually going to do a whole weekend over our Silence Voices project, and it will culminate in a concert, but we will be going into the schools and educating students, you know, about the music, about the Holocaust. So that's an incredible, exciting thing for us coming up, as well as a week-long residency in Arizona next month, which should be nice, especially with the weather here. And then we'll be back to France again. And we do have something really exciting in the area, but I'm not allowed to say anything.
I was just going
to
ask.
Yeah, I know, and I wish I could say. Okay. But hopefully in a couple weeks it'll be announced. And actually, this is something that is really going to be truly special for us and sort of bring our Silenced Voices project full circle. So you'll have to stay tuned for that.
Thank you, Desiree. And now who wants to tell me about Jean-Claude, who I guess is responsible for starting all of this?
Yeah, I mean, really, this was the piece that we didn't find it. I mean, it's one of the more popular trios, I would say, that we play
in the world of string
out
trio.
There. In the world of the eclectic world of string trios. But we thought this piece was absolutely fantastic, and we really wanted an opportunity to keep playing it. And it was a sort of catalyst that for the whole album. So Jean Krah grew up in Brittany, and he was a contemporary of Maurice Ravel. But actually, composing music was really not his day job. He was actually a career naval officer.
So he got to do it. Unlike Tomasi.
Right, yeah, exactly. He really got to do it. And so, yes, he was an admiral eventually, I think, in the French Navy. So all his musical compositions were really inspired by his sea voyages. And I think you'll hear that in a couple of movements that we're going to play. The first, you know, we talked about the feeling of a train in some of the Silence Voices composers. But here it's a sort of, you know, a journey by, you could imagine the sort of chugging of a boat's engine through this first movement. It's really, we love playing this composer's string trio.
Here it is, or rather two movements of it. We'll hear the first movement and the fourth movement, which is Marc Très Animé.
To what David said.
Sure.
Actually, a couple things. First of all, we're very, very thankful to have been invited tonight to play live from WFMT. It's been a long time. Very nice seeing you in person, Carrie, Louise, and Max. Very, very nice seeing you. It's wonderful to be able to make music in front of you.
Good. Well, I can invite you back right now.
Yeah. the last movement of this ska to me sounds like Pirates of the Caribbean. And a nice tie-in is that David is in fact related to a pirate.
Really?
He wasn't a very good pirate. I mean, not that any pirates are particularly good, but he wasn't a very effective pirate. He was more of a wrecker. So in Cornwall, which is where I'm from in England, the southwest tip of England, they used to light sort of bonfires to lure ships and then pillage them when they crashed on those.
Right.
So he wasn't even a brave pirate. So I don't often bring up the... Thanks, Aurelian, for bringing up the pirate.
It was a shoe-in to becoming a cellist.
Yes. You'll hear the pirate.
Okay.
Thank you.
That is music by Jean Croix from the trio for violin, viola, and cello. We heard the first and fourth movements, music which brings us to the end of this concert by Black Oak Ensemble. Violinist Desiree Rustrat, violist Aurelien Petrozzoli, and cellist David Cunliffe. And if you'd like to know more about the group, we urge you to check out their website, which is blackoakensemble.com. If you'd like to see video of tonight's concert, it can be found at WFMT.com or WFMT's Facebook and YouTube channels. Our thanks to these fine musicians for being with us tonight. Thanks also to my co-producer, Louise Frank, and to our music producer, Max LeBien. And we had assistance tonight from Ella Pinsloop. We hope you can join us again next week when we will have as our guests the two laureates of the 2022 Concours International Musical de Montréal in the Art Song Division, the Brooklyn-based soprano Meredith Wolgemuth and vocal collaborative pianist Jinhee Park. I'm Kerry Fremkin, host and producer of these programs, hoping you'll be with us again next Monday night at 8 for more music and performance live from WFMT.